Welcome to lecture 38 on measure and integration. Today we will start looking at the notion of absolute continuity of measures. We have started this concept in the previous lecture, but we will do it in detail in today's lecture. So, we will start with looking at what is called one measure being absolutely continuous with respect to another measure, and then we will prove an important theorem called Radon-Nikodym theorem for absolutely continuous measures. So, let us start recalling what is absolutely continuous measures. So, if two measures mu and nu given on a measure space, measurable space X s, we say nu is absolutely continuous with respect to the measure mu, if for any set E in the sigma algebra S, mu of E equal to 0 implies nu of E equal to 0. That means, if a set E has got mu measure 0, then it should imply that nu measure of the set E is also equal to 0. So, in that case, we write this relation by the symbol that nu with this special symbol, which is less than twice printed. So, it is called absolutely continuous with respect to nu, and this is denoted by this symbol. And we looked at an example of absolutely continuous measures. So, we said let us take a function f, which is non-negative measurable on a measure space X s mu, and let us integrate this function over a set E in the sigma algebra. And so, this integral f is fixed, mu is fixed, E is varying, and this is a non-negative number which we denoted by nu of E. And we had shown when we defined the integral for non-negative functions that nu of E is a measure. And it has a special property that if mu of E is equal to 0, then nu of E is also equal to 0. So, this measure nu of E, which is defined via the integral of a non-negative function f over a set E, implies that this measure nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. Let us give a characterization of absolutely continuous measures in terms of what is called epsilon delta definitions, which looks similar to absolute continuity of functions. So, we want to prove the following, namely if mu and nu are two measures such that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, then the following holds that if nu is finite, then for every epsilon bigger than 0, one can find a delta bigger than 0. Says that whenever nu of E is less than epsilon, nu of E is less than epsilon whenever mu of E is less than delta. That means, given an epsilon, you can find a delta, say that whenever for a set the measure mu of E is less than delta, that should imply nu of E is less than epsilon. So, let us prove this result. So, we are given that nu and mu are measures on the measurable space X s, and nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, and nu is finite. To show for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta bigger than 0 such that mu of E less than delta should imply nu of E is less than epsilon. So, the proof is of this is by contradiction. So, suppose not, means suppose this claim is not true, that will mean what? So, claim is for every epsilon there is a delta. So, that means that there is an epsilon such that then for every epsilon bigger than that means then there exists epsilon bigger than 0 such that for every delta there exists a set E belonging to the sigma algebra with the property whenever mu of E is less than delta, but nu of E is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So, if we assume that the required claim is not true, that will imply that there is a number epsilon bigger than 0, so that for every delta you can choose a set E. Of course, this E will depend on delta, says that mu of E is less than delta, but nu of E is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So, let us apply this result for, so apply this for delta equal to 1 over 2 to the power n. So, that will give us the following. So, when I do that, so for every n there exists a set E n belonging to S such that mu of E is E n is less than 1 over 2 to the power n, but mu of E n is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So, this is what we get if we assume our result is not true. So, now let us define a set E n to be equal to union of E n E k from k equal to 1 to k equal to n to infinity, and A to be equal to intersection of A n's n equal to 1 to infinity. So, let us note the following. The set A n, so mu of A n is less than or equal to sigma mu of E k, k equal to n to infinity, and mu of E k is less than 1 over 2 to the power k, and summation n equal to 1 over 2 to the power n. So, this is going to be equal to 1 over 2 to the power n plus 1. So, mu of A n, because mu of E k will be less than 1 over 2 to the power k. So, this says mu of A n is less than or equal to 1 over 2 to the power n, and this A n is union of n to infinity. So, as n increases, this A n's are going to be smaller and smaller. So, A n is a decreasing sequence and it decreases to the intersection, namely A, right. So, thus nu being finite, A n decreasing to A will imply, so this will imply mu being finite. So, we will have, this will imply that nu of A is equal to limit n going to infinity nu of the set A n. But nu of A n is the intersection, okay, and sorry, intersection of E, sorry, A n, sorry, that is okay, A n's. So, A n is union of E k, okay, and so so let us observe that is bigger than or equal, so and mu of A n is summation, so it is bigger than or equal to nu of E n, because A n is union of E n's, okay, because A n is union of E n's. So, A n includes E n. So, nu of A n, so nu of A n is going to be bigger than or equal to nu of E n, which is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So, that implies, so this along with this implies that nu of A is bigger than or equal to epsilon. But we just now observed that mu of A n was less than or equal to 1 over 2 to the power n plus 1. So, what does that imply? So, that implies that mu of the set A, okay, and because A is equal to intersection of this, so mu of A is less than or equal to mu of A n for every n, so less than or equal to 1 over 2 to the power n plus 1 for every n. So, that implies that mu of A is equal to 0. So, what we have done is, assuming that the required condition does not hold, we have shown that there is a set A, so that mu of A is 0, but nu of A is not equal to 0, it is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So, which is a, so this is the contradiction. So, that implies that what we assumed is not true, and hence we have the required claim, namely that if nu is absolutely continuous with respect to a measure mu and nu is finite, then for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta bigger than 0 such that mu of A less than delta implies nu of the set A has to be less than or equal to epsilon. So, this is what we have proved. So, we have shown that if nu is finite, then the condition that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu implies this required claim. Now, let us prove actually the converse of this statement is also true, namely for every epsilon bigger than 0, if there exists a delta such that nu of E is less than epsilon whenever mu of E is less than delta, then nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. So, let us prove the converse. So, converse says the following, that we have the property that for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta bigger than 0 such that mu of a set E less than delta implies mu of E is less than epsilon. And we want to claim that this property means that nu absolutely continuous with respect to mu. Let us suppose, so let mu of E be equal to 0. So, if mu of E is equal to 0, then for every epsilon, whatever delta we take, for every delta, mu of E is equal to 0 is less than delta. So, that will imply by the given property that nu of E is less than epsilon. So, nu of E is less than epsilon for every epsilon. So, that implies nu of E is equal to 0. So, saying that for every epsilon there is a delta says that mu of E is less than delta implies the nu of E is less than epsilon implies that mu the measure nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. So, the converse is easier, and it is true even if nu is not finite. So, we not use anywhere the fact that nu is finite. So, one way we require nu to be finite, that means absolute continuity and nu finite implies this condition that for every epsilon there is a delta says that mu of E less than delta implies nu of E less than epsilon. For the converse, we do not need this property. So, this is one characterization of absolutely continuous measures. Next, let us recall that we had characterized all measures on the real line on the Borel sigma algebra. We had shown that if a measure mu if given a measure mu on the collection of all Borel measurable sets in the real line, there exists a monotonically increasing right continuous function such that for any interval a comma b, mu of a b is given by f of b minus f of a. So, that is the that gave us the characterization of all countably additive set functions on the sigma algebra of Borel subsets of real line. Using that, we would like to characterize what are all absolutely continuous measures on the real line with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So, the theorem states the following, namely let f be a monotonically increasing right continuous function and mu f be the measure induced by this monotonically increasing right continuous function f on B r. Then the claim is that this measure mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure lambda if and only if the function f is absolutely continuous on every bounded interval. So, we would like to prove this result. So, this will give us that what are all measures which are absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. It ties up with the property of the function f being absolutely continuous. So, this relates the two concepts, absolutely continuous measures and absolutely continuous functions on the real line. So, let us look at a proof of this. So, let us assume that f is monotonically increasing and right continuous. And mu f is the measure on the Borel sets, which is given by, for the left open right closed interval a comma b, it is defined as, if you recall, we defined it as f b minus f of a, and then we showed that this mu f is the measure, is a measure which we called as the measure induced by the function f. So let us so this is given. So let mu f be absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. To show that the function f is absolutely continuous on every interval, say a to b. To show that f is absolutely continuous on every interval a to b, what we have to do? We have to show that for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta. So, to show for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta bigger than 0, such that if we take a sequence of intervals, say ai, bi are finite, disjoint intervals, these are finite disjoint intervals in the interval a b, in the interval a b, with the property, with the property that sigma of b I minus a I is less than delta, then that should imply that sigma I equal to 1 to n f of b I minus f of a I is less than epsilon. So, this is what we have to show. So, let us fix. So, let epsilon greater than 0 be given. So, let us start with an epsilon bigger than 0 be given. Now, since mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to lambda, there exists delta bigger than 0 such that lambda of a set E less than lambda of a set E less than delta will imply that mu f of E is less than epsilon. So, this is by the property we just now proved, that absolute continuity is equivalent to this property, and mu of f on the interval a b is finite, such that for every E inside belonging to the Borel sigma algebra of the interval a b, this is true. So, in particular, if E is a finite disjoint union of intervals a I b I, if E is a finite disjoint union of intervals a I b I inside such that lambda of E, such that lambda of E, which is equal to sigma b I minus a I is less than delta. So, that will imply that mu of f of this set E, but mu of f of this set E is nothing but f of b I minus f of a I, summation I equal to 1 to n is less than epsilon. That is because we have just now given epsilon, we have chosen delta with that property. So, in particular, we are applying this for a set E, which is a finite disjoint union of intervals a I b I inside the interval a b. So, this will imply mu f, and by definition mu f of E, which is a finite disjoint union of intervals, is nothing but sigma f of b I minus. So, that implies, so hence this proves that f on a b to R is absolutely continuous. So one way we approved that if so we approved that if f of mu of f, the measure induced, is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure, then the corresponding function f, the monotonically increasing right continuous function f, which is inducing that measure, is also absolutely continuous. Let us look at the converse of this statement, that we are given that the function f, capital F, which is monotonically increasing and right continuous, is also absolutely continuous. Then we want to show that the corresponding measure mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So, let us prove that fact. So, let us prove that. So, assume that mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to lambda. To show we just now showed, no, we have to show the other way around, sorry. So, this is not, this is just now we have shown. So, assume that f is absolutely continuous. To show, so we have to show that mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to lambda. So, this is what we have to show for the other way around proof. So, let us assume, so let E belong to Br and lambda of E equal to 0. So, to show mu f of E is equal to 0. So, this is what we have to show mathematically. So, now let us observe first of all. So, showing that mu f of E is equal to 0. So, enough to show that mu f of E intersection every interval a to b is equal to 0 for every interval a b, right. So, then we can split E into every interval. So, we can countable additivity will give us that this is 0 for every E. So, let us assume that we have got, so enough to show that this is equal to 0. Now, since lambda of E is 0, so lambda intersection a b is also equal to 0. That means, this set E intersection a b is a set of Lebesgue measure 0. So, by the properties of sets of Lebesgue measure 0, we can find, so let us for a given epsilon, we can find intervals say a n b n. We can choose them to be left open, right close, n bigger than or equal to 1, 2 and so on, such that this the set E, which is a null set intersection a b, is covered by these intervals a n b n, and the total length of this and sigma b n minus a n, n equal to 1 to infinity is less than epsilon. So, total length of this is small. This is by the property that the set E is a null set. So, E intersection a b is a null set. So, by the definition of Hofstra measure, if you like, you can find a sequence of left open, right close intervals which cover this set, and the total length of these recovering intervals is small, is less than epsilon. Okay. So now, let we what we want to show? Our aim is to show that the function f is absolutely continuous. So let us take any number, say alpha. Let alpha bigger than 0 be given. Then it is enough to show that mu of that thing is equal to. So what is to be shown? We are given that f is absolutely continuous. Then by absolute continuity, by absolute continuity of f, there exists, by the absolute continuity of f, there exists some delta bigger than 0, such that whenever intervals a n b n are disjoint in a b with sigma b n minus a n some n equal to some 1 to k, right? Finite number of disjoint intervals a b less than delta will imply that f of b n minus f of a n n equal to 1 to k is less than alpha. So, this is by the absolute continuity of the function f which is given to us. Okay. Now, so we start with, given any alpha bigger than 0, we find a delta with this property. And now, for this delta, we apply our earlier thing that lambda of this was a null set. So, for any given epsilon, so we will use this when epsilon is equal to delta, because when epsilon is equal to delta, we will have the summation of these intervals less than delta, and that will imply, okay. So that will imply the corresponding. So let us call this thing as star. So this thing as star, okay. So by star with epsilon is equal to delta. So by star with epsilon equal to delta, okay. We have, so for so we'll have that sigma of f b n minus f of a n n equal to 1 to k is less than alpha for every k. Okay. So, this happens for every k. Okay. So, that implies that sigma of n equal to 1 to infinity f of b n minus f of a n is also less than alpha, because this is happening for every k. But that implies that mu of E intersection a b, which was mu f of this, which was less than or equal to, because E intersection a b was contained in the union of intervals a and b n. So, it is less than or equal to sigma mu f of a n b n, n equal to 1 to infinity, and this is equal to sigma n equal to 1 to infinity of f of b n minus f of a n, which is less than alpha. So, what we have shown is that for every alpha, mu f of E intersection a b is less than or equal to alpha. So, that implies, so this happens because this is happening for every alpha. So, this implies that mu f of E intersection a b is equal to 0, because this is happening for every alpha. So, we can let alpha go to 0. So, hence we have shown that lambda of phi equal to 0 implies this mu f of A intersection AB is equal to 0 for every AB, and so that implies, because this is happening for every AB, so this implies that mu f is of E is equal to 0. So hence mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to lambda. So this proves the other way around theorem. So this completes the proof of the theorem that mu f is absolutely continuous with respect to lambda if and only if the function f is absolutely continuous on every bounded interval. So this completely characterizes and ties up the notion of absolutely continuous measures on the real line with respect to Lebesgue measure with absolutely continuous functions on the real line. Next, we want to prove a theorem called von Neumann theorem, which is a very nice theorem, and gives a it uses very nicely and very intelligently the fact that the dual of the L2 of a measure space is itself, that we called as the Ries representation theorem, namely that if T is a continuous linear functional on L2 of a measure space, then it is essentially given by the inner product So this is used very effectively. We will not be giving a proof of this theorem. Those who are interested can read the textbook, but we will see how this theorem is used to prove some results about measures. So let us first state this theorem called von Neumann theorem. So the theorem says, let us take two measures mu and nu, which are sigma finite measures on measurable space X S. Then it says there exists mutually disjoint sets X I, measurable sets, such that the following properties hold. First of all, this X1, X2, X3 give a partition of the space X. So, X is partitioned into three parts, X1 union X2 union X3. On X3 and X1, so nu of X3 is equal to 0, that means nu has no, for any subset in X3, the measure of a set is equal to 0. So, that means nu at the most gives values to subsets on X1 and X2. On the other hand, mu of X1 is equal to 0, that means mu gives values to subsets possibly in X2 and X3. So, nu of X1 and nu of X3 is equal to 0, mu of X1 is equal to 0. And on the set X2, there is a function g, which is a non-negative measurable function, such that for every subset E of measurable subset E of X2, nu of E can be written as integral of the function g over the set E. So, it in some sense describes, so it says, so let us take this is my set X, and we have got two measures mu and nu. It says we can decompose into three parts x1, x2 and x3. And on this part, nu of x1 is 0. On this part, mu of x3 is equal to 0. So, in this part, nu is 0. In this part, mu is 0. And on this part, x2, this nu of any set E, for any set E here, it can be written as integral over E of g d mu. So, this property holds on this set. So, this is a decomposition of the von Neumann. So, let us just recall. So, the von Neumann decomposition theorem says that given two measures nu and mu and nu, which are sigma finite of course, we can decompose X into three parts. X is equal to x1 union x2 union x3. Nu of x3 is equal to 0. Mu of x1 is equal to 0, and on the middle part x2, the measure nu can be represented in terms of the measure mu by the property that nu of E is equal to integral g d mu. So, this is called von Neumann's theorem, and it is very useful theorem, we will see soon. So, using this theorem, we prove what is called the Lebesgue decomposition theorem. So, Lebesgue decomposition theorem says the following, that suppose mu and nu are two sigma finite measures on a measurable space X S, then it implies that there exists sigma finite measures nu A and nu S with the following properties. Namely, this measure nu can be written as a sum of two measures nu lower A and plus nu lower S. So, the measure nu can be written as the sum of two measures nu of A plus nu of S. And what are the properties of these two measures? The first property says that measure nu of A is representable in terms of the measure mu via integrals. So, it says nu of A for any subset E is integral of a non-negative measurable function f over the set E. So, it says there exists a unique non-negative measurable function f such that to compute nu of A of any set E, we just integrate f over the set E. And the second part says it describes what is the measure nu S. It says there is a set A such that mu of A complement is 0 and nu S of A is equal to 0. That means, mu and nu S are sitting on disjoint sets. Mu of A complement is 0. So, that means, mu sits on A and nu S of A is equal to 0. So, nu S is on A complement essentially. So, this is what is called Lebesgue decomposition theorem. So, we want to show that how it arises out of as an application of von Neumann's theorem. So, and this is also a part of the consequence that such a decomposition is unique. So, let us look at by von Neumann theorem, given the measures nu and mu, we have disjoint sets x 1, x 2 and x 3 such that the following property holds. We recall that x is equal to x 1 union x 2 union x 3 and nu of x 3 is equal to 0 and mu of x 1 is equal to 0. So, mu does not give any mass or does not give any measure to this set x 1 and nu does not give any measure to this set x 3. And on x 2, we recall that for every set E, a measurable set, if we look at E intersection x 2, then we can compute this measure as an integral of a non-negative measurable function g over this set E intersection x 2. And moreover, recall this is a non-negative, g is a non-negative measurable function and g is equal to 0 on the complement of the set E 2. So, that is the because the measure nu on x 3 is equal to 0. So, this is a by von Neumann's theorem. Now, it is easy to define what should be our measures nu A and so on the set x 2, we should define nu A to be equal to nu on x 2. So, let us define, let us put A equal to x 2 union x 3 and on this set, for every set E belonging to S, nu of A of E is defined as nu of A intersection E and on the complement of this part. So, nu S of E, that is going to be E intersection x 1, because x 1 is the complement of A, that is A complement. So, define nu, the measure nu as nu of A intersection E, restrict nu to E and restrict nu to x 1 to get the measure nu S. And now, obviously, these two are nu S and nu A are measures, that is obvious from the definition. And also is clear from the definition that the measure nu is nothing but nu A, because nu A is on A and nu S is on A complement. So, nu is nothing but nu A plus nu S. And the measure nu S on A complement is equal to 0. So, this satisfies the required properties. Only we have to check that nu of A is given by the integral, and that is obvious because nu A of E is nu of E intersection x 2 union x 3 by the definition, because A is x 2 union x 3, and on x 2 it is given by E intersection x 2 integral g d mu, because nu of x 3 is equal to 0. So, nu of A is given by the integral. So, that proves the theorem, except for the fact that at present g is defined only on x 2. So, there is not a issue, we can extend it to the whole by putting it equal to 0. Then it has the required property that f is defined as a non-negative measurable function defined on the whole space x, and nu A of E is given by the integral. So, that proves Lebesgue decomposition theorem, and the uniqueness is only a manipulation of the measures. So, which will leave it as a reading exercise for the reader to verify. So, uniqueness we'll assume the uniqueness part of it. So, Lebesgue decomposition. So, let me go back and state understand what is Lebesgue decomposition theorem. It says that given two sigma finite measures on a measure space, the measure, one of the measures, say let us nu, can be written as a sum of two measures nu A and nu S, where nu A is given by integration and nu S sits on a part which is complement to the part of mu of A. So, this is nu of A is given as an integral, and mu of A complement is same as nu S of A is equal to 0. So, this theorem is called Lebesgue decomposition theorem. So, this the measure nu S that we have defined just now gives a let us make it as a definition. So, two measures mu and nu are said to be singular with respect to each other, or we say mu is singular with respect to nu, if there is a set say that mu of the set E is 0 and nu of the E complement is equal to 0. That essentially says we can decompose the space X into two parts, E and E complement, and mu sits on one part and nu sits on the other part. So, such measures are called singular, and it is obvious that if mu is singular with respect to nu, then nu is singular with respect to mu. So, it is a commutative relation of singularity, while absolute continuity was not. So, nu absolutely continuous with respect to mu need not imply mu is absolutely continuous, while the singularity is true, that namely if mu is, and this singular is also written as mu perpendicular. So, this is also read as singularity is also said mu is orthogonal or mu is perpendicular to nu, and written as mu perpendicular to the nu. So, Lebesgue decomposition theorem now can be stated in terms of this singularity, that given two measures which are sigma finite on a measure space X S, there exist sigma finite measures nu A and nu S such that the following properties hold, namely nu is decomposed into two parts nu A plus nu S, where nu of A is absolutely continuous with respect to mu and nu S is orthogonal with respect to mu. So, this is the decomposition, that essentially it says that the measure nu has got absolutely continuous part, and absolute continuous part says you can obtain nu of A via integration, and singular part says that this is the other part which is completely orthogonal to mu. So, they sits disjoint, says you can't do anything there, they are disjoint sets. They sit on what one says their sports are disjoint essentially. So, this is what is called Lebesgue decomposition theorem. And as a consequence of this, we will get what is called the Radon-Nikodym theorem, which characterizes absolutely continuous measures. And it says that if two measures mu and nu, which are sigma finite on a measurable space X S, be such that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, then there is a non-negative measurable function f such that nu of E is given via integration over of f over the set E. So, that completely characterizes absolutely continuous measures. Recall, if we define nu of E by this, then we have already shown that was the beginning of our analysis, saying that any measure nu defined in terms of integral with respect to mu is absolutely continuous, and this is the converse part of it, namely, if nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, then there must be a non-negative measurable function f such that nu of E is equal to integral of f over E with respect to the measure mu. And proof is obvious from the Lebesgue decomposition theorem, the uniqueness part of it, because we know that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. So, when we apply Lebesgue decomposition theorem to the measures nu and mu, nu will be decomposed into two parts, the absolutely continuous part and the singular part. But there is no singular part, so there is only absolutely continuous part, and the absolutely continuous part we have already seen in Lebesgue decomposition theorem is given by integrals. So, this is a direct application of Lebesgue decomposition theorem, and this function f is also unique in the sense that if there are two functions, then f must be equal to g almost everywhere. And that happens because if there is another function g with the same property, then integral of f over every set E is equal to integral of g over every set E, and that implies that f must be equal to g almost everywhere, that we have seen earlier. So, Radon-Degardin theorem, the proof is an application of Lebesgue decomposition theorem, and Lebesgue decomposition theorem is an application of von Neumann's theorem. So, once again saying that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, by Lebesgue decomposition theorem, nu of A must be equal to nu, because that is absolutely continuous and nu of S is equal to 0. So, that says that nu of E is given by integral over f by the Lebesgue decomposition theorem. And as such, we said uniqueness is obvious, because integral f is equal to integral g must imply that f is equal to g almost everywhere. So, this is Radon-Nikodym theorem is one of the most important and subtle theorems of our subject, because just from the existence of same null sets mu of E equal to 0 implies nu of E equal to 0. This property, simple property about null sets, says that nu must be obtainable from mu via integration. It's really a deep and amazing theorem of our subject. And let me also point out, there are many proofs available of this theorem. We have given a proof which is via von Neumann's theorem, and von Neumann's theorem uses the fact that the dual of L2 is L2. And there is another purely measure theoretic proof of this, but that goes into the realm of what is called signed measures. So, one looks at signed measures and then one decomposes a signed measure. There is something called the Hahn decomposition theorem, that every signed measure is a difference of two measures, and then from there one deduces Lebesgue decomposition theorem and then comes to Radon-Nikodym theorem. So, that is another route possible for proving this theorem. So, both the proofs are available in the text, and we have outlined here only one proof, which is more function theoretic, using that dual of L2 is L2. Well, this gives the notion of absolute continuity, also gives rise to the notion of what is called the derivative. So, let us define that. So, whenever two measures mu and nu are sigma finite and nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, so Radon-Nikodym theorem says that nu of E must be given by a function, a unique function f. This unique function f is called the Radon-Nikodym derivative of the measure nu with respect to mu, and is denoted by d nu by d mu. So, here are some simple properties of this Radon-Nikodym derivative, which are very much similar to the derivative of functions. Namely, if mu 1, mu 2 and nu are sigma finite measures, then and if mu I each mu 1 and mu 2 is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, then mu 1 plus mu 2 is also absolutely continuous, and the Radon-Nikodym derivative of the sum is equal to sum of the Radon-Nikodym derivatives, of course, almost everywhere. So, very much similar to the derivative of the sum is equal to sum of the derivatives for functions. And similarly, if mu 1 is absolutely continuous with respect to mu 2, sorry, this is a mistake here, and mu 2 is absolutely continuous with respect to mu 1, that means both are absolutely continuous with respect to each other, then the product of the derivatives is equal to 1. So, that is the second property. So, here it should be mu 2 absolutely continuous with respect to mu. And finally, if nu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu 1 and mu 1 is absolutely continuous with respect to mu 2, then there is a kind of associativity property. Namely, this implies that nu must be absolutely continuous with respect to mu 2, and the derivative, so d mu 2 over d nu is computable as d mu 2 over d mu 1 multiplied by the derivative d mu 2 over this should be d nu here, this should be d nu. So, it is like a chain rule for the derivative functions. So, with that idea of redundancy, this set of ideas namely absolutely continuous functions and absolutely continuous measures is complete. And in the remaining next lecture, we will look at some special properties of sequences of measurable functions and the ways various ways they can converge to a function f. Thank you.